this gospel is about the genealogy of Jesus Christ. In other words, it tells us where Jesus comes from through a list of his ancestors. The genealogy of Jesus is how the Gospel of St. Matthew begins. You might wonder why St. Matthew began his Gospel in such a way. On the surface, it's a rather boring list, with some of the names so difficult to pronounce. So why did Matthew present us with such a long list of names? Well, the main reason for Matthew giving us Jesus' genealogy is that he wants us to show us that Jesus comes from the line of King David, something prophesied in the Old Testament. St. Matthew wanted to show that Jesus was the fulfillment of a prophecy, that he was indeed the promised Messiah. As Filipinos, we can appreciate the importance of family history, of knowing where we come from. In our culture, we are taught from a very young age that family is everything. How often have we heard from our lolas or nanay, without family, you have nothing? This is generally true, but we must also be sensitive to the reality that not everyone belongs to a loving family. Many live on their own, not by choice, but out of necessity. Today we think about the family that Jesus Christ was born into, Mary and Joseph, the Holy Family. What can we say about the Holy Family? Well, for one thing, they are seen as a model family for us to imitate. Modello is a familia, but in what ways can we imitate them? After all, they are the Holy Family. How can we possibly emulate them? Well, firstly, the Holy Family was a family in which both parents worked hard. They understood and accepted each other, and they took good care of Jesus so that he might grow up not only in human knowledge and wisdom, but also as a child of God. In turn, we should also strive to make our own homes, places where learning is not just encouraged, but actually acquired. The Catechism of the Catholic Church teaches that parents have the first responsibility for the education of their children. They bear witness to this responsibility first by creating a home where tenderness, forgiveness, respect, fidelity, and disinterested service are the rule. The home is well suited for education in the virtues. This is one of the reasons why, in our first curriculum program in Bishop Stortford, my parish, I insist that we catechize the parents as well as the children. This first and foremost is the parents' job to catechize, to teach their children. The catechists, the priests, are merely support. Secondly, we must remember that it wasn't all plain sailing for the Holy Family. It wasn't a bed of roses for them. If you recall, they had to go into exile after Jesus was born to escape from Herod, who wanted to kill baby Jesus. They were a poor, working class family and had to work hard to put food on the table. And of course, Mary was Jesus' daughter. cross, possibly the most painful thing a mother could experience. So what sustained the Holy Family through all those trials? The answer is love for one another and love for God. We can see Jesus' love for his mother when he was dying on the cross and gave her into the care of his closest disciple, John, with these memorable words, "Woman, behold your son." And then to the beloved disciple, "Behold your mother." Modern-day families are also facing some struggles, problems, and difficulties. In Western countries such as here in England, there is much talk of crisis in the institution of the family, and it is a serious crisis. Traditional family values are threatened by radical ways of seeing the family. In developing countries such as our country, the Philippines, separation of family members has become commonplace. When parents migrate, the children are often left behind. Parents do this for the best of reasons, that is, to provide financial stability for their children. But this does mean they get separated from their children, at least for a while. Then love, understanding, and patience become even more important if the family bond is to survive. But there are also certain situations where a family looks complete when everyone is together under one roof, and yet the members wouldn't connect or communicate with each other when there is dysfunction or, sadly, even abuse. How do we address this problem? We can learn something from the Holy Family. The Holy Family is characterized by love for each other. Love is what sustains them. Today, what holds families together in times of difficulty is also love and forgiveness that hasn't changed. What has changed is that we allow ourselves to love material things, sometimes even more than our family members. And as a result, we don't spend enough time together. Some children, and some parents too, are so busy looking at screens that they no longer talk or look at their parents. By the same token, some parents are so focused on providing for the material needs of their children that they neglect the emotional and spiritual support they should also be giving to their children. So, for the rest of this Advent season and beyond, let us make a promise to spend more time with one another. Last night I said that we should make time, more time, to be with the Lord. It is equally important to make time for those around you, not your friends and family members, but especially in Advent and Christmas time. Also spend time and pray for the lost and the lonely in your community who need you to tell them and to show them that they matter as well. The Holy Family survived all its crisis through their love for each other and their faith in God. Let us pray during this Mass that struggling families pull through with their love for each other and their faith in God. Let us now stand for